Actually, I should have brought my kids. Should have brought one of my chairs, too. Mort, are you ready? He's ready? You want me to stand? Well, our speaker tonight is Jim Hall, and the owner of Huddle, what is it called, Huddle Incorporated?
Just plain Huddle.
Huddle, that has four stores in the area, and it has the own manufacturing. And he went to USC and worked with Ralph Knowles, is that correct? And also with Conrad Boxman, and went back to MIT and took his master's in urban design. And so I hope to get him to go through his whole life and what makes him tick and why he gave up architecture, and or did he ever give up architecture and that sort of thing. And his wife, Penny, is here as well, and maybe during the question and answer they could feel it together or something. There might be some questions for her as well. Okay, Jim Hall.
I thought I'd start out by just showing a series of slides of what, you know, what we've done for the last 6 years after I decided that architecture was not the quickest way to get anywhere, and that there had to be some other way. And get anywhere being not money, but you know, getting to design the kind of things that I felt that I wanted to design anyway. So we started this company about 6 years ago right now, and what I'd like to do is just shoot through about 20 slides real fast, and I'm not going to stop, and you aren't going to understand them or anything. We'll just give some idea for those of you who have never seen anything that we do, or even if you do now and haven't seen what it was 5 years ago or how we got here. So I'll do this real fast first. And then later on, either in a question and answer period or after I kind of talk about some things, I might go through them again or show some more specifics, and then I can talk about what they really are, or you know, why we did them. Okay, you want to... Okay, can you start that sound? No? A louder? Thank you. That was the fastest. That was a fast 6 years. Okay, now, after seeing that, what I feel is important to anyone who is, you know, if I'm going to talk about, you know, why I've done anything, I feel that anyone who tries to do anything is, you know, they're kind of a result of their own background and the experiences they had, whether it was in school or other people that were important influences on their life. And whether it's in architecture or any type of design, I felt at the time that I decided to do something other than building structures, that I wanted to really analyze what I had done for about 26 years up to that point, and then kind of make a plan for getting to where I wanted to be in about 10 years. And the real reason that I started this was a dissatisfaction with problems I had had with clients. And it always seemed on my best projects after I got out of school, my clients always did something to me. I mean, they either had a heart attack at the wrong time, or they were influenced by minor members of their staff into deciding that my ideas were too radical, wrong, something. So I decided to get rid of clients, and no matter what it meant, even if it meant I had to open a little tiny factory myself or whatever. This came in about a 2-year period after returning here from MIT. To give you a little further background, I went in through a fairly innovative architecture program at USC under Ralph Knowles, and was one of the first group that got out of that. It was a program that the profession eventually got rid of because it was too, it was not professional enough, let's say. You know, the main thing about that program was an analysis of all the natural forces acting on any design or any structure or any project at all. The forces of sun, wind, rain, movement, whatever. I felt at that time, after several years of that, that I was still had a real lack of what I needed as a designer to start working, however. And my last year there was in a program with Conrad Voxman with building systems. It was actually a graduate program, but a very intense time. And the important thing there then was starting to think a little bit about the economics of building and the using of machines and prefabrication methods and things that it looks from your environment that all of you are thinking of too. However, after a year of that, I felt still a real lack of a whole concern for, let's say, a humanist aspect of what design is. And so after a short stint with Victor Gruen, got into a program at MIT in urban design. And during that time, basically to analyze not only the idea of developing systems, but finding out socially and kind of psychologically what kind of structures or projects or communities, you know, work and why they work. It was a very interesting group because I basically split it off from all the other people that were there in doing their straight design work and got involved with a group at Harvard and MIT in the development of a cooperative community, and also another very intensive group analyzing the psychological aspects of urban or environmental form. So, you know, if there's any questions later on about what we did or, you know, what came out of that, I felt it was very important and that the things that we studied at that point were things that I had never really come in contact with in architecture schools before that. It was really looking at all aspects of a city and why it works or doesn't work, and trying to develop systems that interrelate all those aspects. So after moving back here then, and I had an office for a couple years, it was a combination of an office and being on sabbatical to analyze all the different things that, you know, had been fed into me for 20-some years, and then deciding, you know, where we were going to go. Well, as I said, the office ended up being a series of problems with clients, and so finally decided, okay, that's where we stop that and we start doing something else that we can control at a real level and a scale that is in some regards very insignificant, but in others, at least, it was a starting point. So when we started to design furniture, it came as a way of looking at a product line in the same way we'd look at a city. And one example would be if, you know, admittedly we were in a city, and being in Los Angeles to me was very important, because when we were in Cambridge, no one could believe that I wanted to move back to Los Angeles and that I wasn't going to San Francisco or, you know, out in the woods somewhere. And that was a real time of a lot of people kind of migrating to the woods. But I really felt that there were a lot of things to be offered by the city, and that especially Los Angeles needed someone to think through some of their problems. So we moved back here, and so even with furniture, we tried to kind of think about, let's say, materials. If you live out in the country somewhere and you need a chair, it seems the easiest thing is to go chop down a tree and cut it up and to make some kind of a chair out of it. In an urban context, then what kind of materials do we have that are readily available, that are maybe too available, that are waste, you know, products? And that's when I started looking at these tubes, because they were both plentiful, cheap, and completely made out of recycled materials. The other things then were trying to, eventually we really started with trying to design very inexpensive furniture systems. In addition to that, there was the idea that the furniture pieces themselves should be very simple, and kind of contrast to the complexities of the people that use them and the background and everything that happens around them, which is why the first shapes we worked with were very simple. The other major idea in the beginning was to try to find materials that had been developed for other uses, in addition to the tubes, just you know, this foam that was on some of those chairs that was developed as a packing material, and really try to kind of recycle the energy that went into developing something, the energy and money, to use it in a new way. I guess, you know, the other things that made us start the thing were to decide how can I, with two children and a wife too, get into something where I can become very involved in it and still make the urban society work to my benefit. How can I, you know, if I were out in the woods somewhere with my family, I could be running my farm or whatever, and you know, have a family and still be doing my little thing. Now, how can you make the city, where you're moving all over all the time, work for you and still develop something that you want to be very, very involved in? So that's why we started this little store in Westwood, a little office, a little factory smaller than this area right here, all within, you know, a half mile of each other. And from there, it's just kind of grown. Unfortunately, in some cases, you find that you get kind of locked into certain things. You have the need to expand your production if you're going to make anything, and not go out of business like everyone else I've known who has started businesses at the same time. So there's that, unfortunately, in a way, there's that growth in there, and you don't, you're never really ready for it, and you don't, you really shouldn't grow in a lot of ways, because it takes a lot of time and money to develop anything, any product, to a point where it's really, let's say, well worked out. However, you find that, I found anyway, that if we didn't grow and we didn't expand, that there was no money to work that product out and until you get the next step up. And so with that then came kind of a constant push to develop new products and to develop the environment in which to sell them. And then we found also in our case that we needed some kind of bread and butter things to keep us going. Maybe at this point I should go back through those slides and kind of describe a little more what, you know, materials or, you know, whatever from that. Because I think that the things that we have done are probably seem very simplistic, and perhaps they are. A lot of the thinking that goes into anything, I'm sure, you know, really isn't ever apparent, but I'll just start back through these, and if you have any questions at this time, too, while we're doing it, you can ask them. Okay, these are just, as I say, these tubes that seemed big and bold, and they were made out of the right material, and it was a material that we could deal with, you know, on a very low budget, with a handsaw and whatever in the beginning. The only real piece of material of equipment that we had to start with was this big saw that we bought and refurbished and extended so it would cut, you know, all these large forms. This is an example of the material. As I say, everything there was developed for another purpose, and so all we did is gather these things together and put them together in a new way and sold it for $30. And a strange thing happened, though, and this is, other people always ask us, you know, well, what happened to your low-cost furniture? We found out that people really don't want low-cost furniture. And the people that like the idea or can appreciate it or, you know, are not the same people that even have usually any money or any money to spend on even low-cost furniture. So from the very beginning, the cheapest things never sold. It was always the top things, because the people that, you know, like when I got out of school, I didn't have any money to buy a chair. If it were $20, I wouldn't buy it. I'd go build something myself or whatever. And so that's it's kind of a you know, misconception that a lot of people have. You want something very fine, very finely crafted or whatever, at also a very low price, and that doesn't ever come together. That was just the same idea. Okay, now we can at least paint it, I guess, and or let people, you know, do it themselves. We really started in the beginning with trying to sell the components that people could finish themselves in as many ways as possible. And in the end, I'll show you what, at least we have something once again in that regard. We just played with a lot of shapes. We found out that with this one great big bandsaw, we could cut all these different shapes, and we just kind of had a tube experience. The whole idea of that cushion was to analyze the way people really sit, not the way they're kind of told to sit, and to then put, you know, design a supporting surface for that. And we found that, first of all, everyone slouches and no one ever sits up straight, it seems, in a kind of leisure environment anyway. And then also that if you look at the weight, where your weight of your body is at different points on your body in a seated position, you find that it varies from, you know, there's a stress, for instance, in this chair, most of a person's weight is concentrated, well, down in the lower part. So by going to a multiple faceted cushion like that, we could have four different densities of foam. The lightest weight and softest foam at the top, and then working down, the middle one supporting the small of your back. The cushion parts?
More or less the cardboard.
Okay, they were glued and mainly glued, but they were in the beginning even nailed. It was pretty crude.
Any specific glue? White glue?
Yeah, just plain old white glue, sure. The cushions, the cushion was the undoing in this whole system. This whole thing was started as a low-cost chair. The idea was to take foam and coat it with some kind of a latex or dip it in something so that it would hold up and not disintegrate in the atmosphere. That was never possible, and we tried for a long time. So finally we had to go to these. This is a horrible photograph. Sewing each one of those. And it was a popular chair with people that had money. They'd plunk down their cash for it. But it was not inexpensive anymore. There's a zipper in every one of those cylinders, and they're all sewn together, and it's a seamstress's nightmare to make that thing when it's all flat. It looks huge, you can't tell what you're doing. And so in the end, we dropped it because it didn't start out that way, and either the base, therefore, had to be some kind of an expensive fiberglass material, and then go ahead and sell it for a high price in the contract trade or whatever. But that wasn't what we started out to do, so instead of do something that really didn't fit the original image, we dropped the whole thing. Oh, this was a little fun we had one day out in the desert. That chair fell off that rock, by the way. And it fell down about 10 feet. And the only thing that happened is it cracked right at the back point, right up where the two tubes connect there. And none of it, I mean, it's just solid cardboard, but nothing else happened. This was just another tube in another way, just opening it up for a bookcase. This was a group called Chrysalis, which some of you know of, that I was working with actually before we started the furniture, and we were working with different inflatable structures, a playpen, and then I split off, and then they did the dome. So we did this, set this up for a couple magazine articles actually, and the tube in the front is kind of a unique thing that. It's really great as a sculpture, I think. Yeah, it's very comfortable to sit in, and the whole idea of it was that two people sit facing each other in that tube. Kind of, it's hard to describe anyway. leaning back against the sides, and it's like a double womb, actually. And you find that, maybe you found it in your structures that you work in around here, but in that tube anyway, it was a very soft, even though it's a hard surface, it's a very soft environment. The distance you are from the person for speaking, it was just right. The amount of enclosure was just right, and you could sit there talking to someone for the longest time, even though you would never guess that you could. These are just, that chair in the middle has an inner tube in it. And it was a stretch fabric over the outside, and it was just a mylar covered tube. Unfortunately, at that time, we could never find a fabric that would hold up over many, many sittings and not stretch in the middle. This was a beginning to think about children's environments and changeable things and what kids really needed. And after we started looking at this whole area of design, we found that basically no one was really designing for children. So this was just a huge movable, changeable toy system. And it looks very rigid in a way right there, but those are just gigantic blocks that all kids can put together in any number of ways. They just stack, and the more weight you put on them, the harder they press together, and the more solid they become. You can stack the thing up, 50 feet probably. But we found out one thing. This was really done for a Home magazine article, and I found that even though there was a double page picture in Home magazine, and a lot of people came in and wanted them, and then they saw how big they were, And everyone said, well, gee, you know, my junior has a little tiny room now. Where can I put this? If I put it outside, will it withstand, you know, nature? And we found that it wouldn't. And we worked for a long time on waterproofing these tubes. And by the time we really got them waterproof, they cost more than the whole thing was worth. So then we decided that, wait a minute, we really better look at, you know, what an urban child has first, you know, to play with or his space. And you look at a typical bedroom and you realize there isn't much there. So if you are to design, you know, develop something for that child to express himself with, and this was another whole attitude of kind of looking at the city compared to a rural, you know, child. If you're growing up in the country, you have tree houses, you have barns or whatever. And if you're stuck in a little tiny room in your, you know, suburban house or your city house, you know, what do you have? So this is why we took what we learned from that other project, and we decided, okay, let's make something that can function both as a bed, because every child needs a bed, and also a complete kind of play environment. The other thing that was really, I felt important at the time and has really proven itself out, is that a child needs a space that is very secure to him based on his scale. You know, we always, every child's bedroom is designed for us. The door has to be the same height, the ceiling has to be the same height. And so we found that with this, kids really respond and feel secure in the sleeping in this tube. And I think a lot of people that even still come into our stores and look at it and say, well, that's very young and kids will outgrow it in a year. Well, it's a full-length tube. I mean, I can sleep in it. And kids basically don't. I mean, they really, maybe we're doing something wrong, I don't know. But they really like the security of sleeping in there. And our own kids have tried them now for 5 years and they're still in them. And everyone we have talked to that has children in them, it isn't something they outgrow. We were very careful in the beginning to do non-objective structures or forms. Everyone 5 years ago said, why don't you do a racing car bed? I'm going to go buy one of those. And it was true. I mean, I'm sure they sold many millions of racing car beds in the time that we've been making the same thing here. But kids outgrow that right away. I mean, anything that's objective, because if you really think about what kids do compared to, well, adults in some ways, kids fantasize about everything. I mean, they live in a fantasy world. All their play is fantasy. So what today is a rocket ship is tomorrow is a castle or whatever. So for that reason, you know, you shouldn't give them objective things that are always one certain thing, you know, a race car. So these are just a couple shots here kind of showing the way kids play in this thing and climb all over it. This is, we set it up in two different ways. By facing one tube each way, it gave each child, if two children were living in the same room, it gave them their own half of the room. You'd put that right in the middle of the room. So they have their own little space. And we found that that was something, too, that kids really related to. So do I. Okay, this was our first little factory, and this was sometime in December, our first or second year, and we were all going crazy trying to get a big order out for design research. And everything always goes wrong in those kind of situations. We found that tubes take up an awful lot of room to store. So we ended up with a tiny little workspace about as wide as the doors just inside, and all the rest were tubes, because you can't buy tubes in small quantities. You got to buy whole truckloads. And so we're all out there working a lot in the back until the neighbors got mad because they said that we were creating a nuisance even though we were in an M1 area, and that they would force us out by, even the planning department said, you can work there. Neighbors can keep they can have you arrested for creating a nuisance even if they don't like what you're doing for almost any reason. And so we had these apartments that lived back, and we were working at 2 o'clock in the morning and all hours. And they caused us a lot of trouble, and we finally had to move. Oh, this is... Okay, the next stage kind of to us was, you know, we didn't feel it was really valid to design a product and without considering the environment that it is shown in, that in this case, that it was sold in, because just like you people hopefully are going to be designing buildings and you can create the whole thing, the inside, the outside, the only thing you can't create is the whole milieu that it fits into, but that's one reason I had gone into urban design, thinking I can design larger scale things where I can control all the junk around, you know, what I'm working on. So when I found that I couldn't do that, at least I decided if I was going to start small, I was going to control the entire environment that I was going to fit my little systems into. So this was just our little storefront in Westwood, and as I look back on it now, there are an awful lot of tubes in that room. But somehow, and the other idea that was really important to me at the time was that, you know, I didn't want a client. I didn't mind having a customer or the public, but no clients. And so instead of taking some ideas to a manufacturer and saying, look, you know, gee, isn't this great? Wouldn't you like to make it? And have him say, ugh, I think it stinks. Why don't you get out? You know, I couldn't take that. You know, I realize I'm not going to be shot down by anyone, so therefore I'm going to take it to the public. And the public is either going to say it by not buying anything, or they're going to say, yeah, great, you know, and they're going to buy it. And so I found that the second way was best in that case, and the public did like it. Although I'm sure any other manufacturer or whatever wouldn't. So from the very beginning, the public started buying a few things anyway. Of course, we could get by on very little at that point, too. That tube on the left side goes up to our house, which was upstairs. There's a chrome door on the back side, and we lived upstairs and opened the store downstairs. I tried to use another material for a while and got burned real bad by finding out that aluminum is creates a lot more problems than fiber tubes. This was our second store, which was in a shopping center down in Orange County, and it was the first chance to take a shell of a space that was not built out yet and, you know, create everything. The inside is actually maybe better than the outside. It's something that really hasn't worked out, by the way, and it's all going to be changed in the next 2 months. Because even though I wanted to express somehow on the outside of the building what was on the inside and what we were dealing with, we found that for display, the objects that we were making and became known for, which were very large, could not be displayed in a window. In a round window that size, anyway. So even though I put a lot of time into that storefront, those are big tanks, by the way. What I did is have a big 6-foot diameter fiberglass tank made and then cut it into sections. The mirror contractor almost went bankrupt on us because he didn't realize how big of a problem it was going to be to put that in. Okay, these are just now, I'm going through a quick series of slides of just. This is a bread and butter. If you're ever going to get into design of anything, develop something that, you know, almost everyone needs and is a low enough cost that you can sell all over. And then use that to the revenue from that to do whatever else you want to do. I've tried not to make that be a product that was something I didn't believe in or I think didn't work. The whole idea of these was the Mylar really does work in reflecting the plant. If you put a fern in those, it reflects the plant. The plant looks bigger. It blends into any environment by disappearing. In the beginning, they'd come out in magazines or some catalogs would buy them and put them in, and they'd do a photograph not knowing what they were photographing, and you'd look at the picture, and they'd disappear. So we found out that we had to really get into our own photography, even for other people's catalogs. This is just the... It took 5 years to develop that bed to the point where it is now. And now it's very expensive, unfortunately. But to work out all the details and dealing with materials... These tubes, by the way, you can't use any kind of close tolerances because they will absorb moisture in the air and humidity. The humidity the day they were made, for instance, has a big effect on their stability and their shrinkage. And so you have to work out details that in, I guess in architecture too, you have expansion and contraction problems. Normal furniture you do not, but in our materials we really found that we did. What? The tubes? Yeah, the tubes are made by the same company that makes concrete column forms, and they make them specially for us. They hate us because concrete column forms can get kicked around a lot, and who cares? But for our tubes, we have to keep them smooth. The guy that runs a huge machine that does it has nightmares keeping it running just perfectly, because if the plies overlap, it doesn't look smooth when we laminate the vinyls to it. In the beginning, we painted everything, and we found out that for the durability that you need in dealing with children, that there had to be other ways. And so that's why the vinyls, the bright colors there, are all different vinyls laminated to the surfaces. All the edging is an extruded plastic edging, so that generally a child can take a baseball bat to any part of that and can hardly dent it, but can't chip it or anything else. Oh, this is just a secondary system we developed, which was a little more straightforward. If you give kids their choice as to which one of those kind of sleeping environments they want, they'll go for the other one. The parents will always go for this one, almost always. It is cheaper also, though, but basically because it's, more like what they grew up in, and there's only a few that really are trying to think like their children when they buy something for them. This was a system that we started on about 2 years ago, and then it came out last year, and it was just trying to develop a more flexible series of parts that could make a wide-ranging number of pieces of furniture. The other thing was to use the floor space more functionally in a room, too. So the very same parts then go together in a different way to make a different bed, to make the dresser desk thing. All the wooden parts are packed inside the tubes inside of a very small cardboard box. So the diameter of the tube that is a supporting element came about by the packing of the lineal wood pieces in it. This is the first time I ever used wood, and it's a soft wood, and the more I found out about woods, I didn't want to use any kind of a hardwood tree or material that's either endangered or, takes hundreds of years to grow. Softwoods grow pretty quickly, and I found that in this particular design, which I was originally going to make out of particle board, that by the time I finished all the lineal elements, it would cost as much as using this wood. And so we decided to do it. This wood comes from the deep south, and it's a pine that is very dense. And as far as I know, it's not used for anything in this part of the country. It's southern yellow pine, which is about as dense and strong as Douglas fir, but it does not splinter like Douglas fir, and takes a very good finish. Oh, this bed in the background then is what we call our loft bed. And what I became more and more concerned with is, in these tiny little rooms, is giving kids more play space, because I realized that even though they had fun playing on those tall beds, in a small room, what they really need is floor space. So what we did is do a bed on top and a dresser and a desk, and kind of opened up the floor space of the room. Oh, these are Penny's fabrics. We decided that since Mary Mecco Design Research wouldn't let us sell Mary Mecco in Los Angeles, because at the time we asked them, they decided at the same time to open their own store here in Beverly Hills. So we decided, well, we should get into that too. I don't recommend really getting into the range of things that we've tried to do, because it's very easy to either lose your mind or lose production of even one thing becomes a real problem. And I don't see how we keep anyone working for us because of the range of problems that we give to them now, but somehow we're still trying. We designed, this is backwards in there, but we found that as a way of, because our fabrics are basically for walls, and they're bolder than just about anything, that most stores, in order to sell fabrics and to frame them, needed a huge area. And so we developed this display as a way of packaging, just in a kit form, the fabrics and wooden stretcher bars inside. So this is just a picture inside of our own house, and everything but the piano is ours, including the the wall hanging up above the piano, which was a design of this. I forgot, Glenn, I do have one picture of something up there, which was a city project that I was working on at MIT, where I tried to really start with a pedestrian's viewpoint and develop forms which were that did not always relate to that walking person in the same way. Basically not vertical always, but structures that would create a very, let's say, complex three-dimensional spatial relationship for that walking individual. I can't go into that at all with that small model there. Anyway, the other thing that this kind of shows is that if something is simple enough, it can fit with something that's very complex. I felt that the things that are in any kind of interior environment, the complexity comes from either what was real to the guy that was carving the legs on that piano, that isn't a molded plastic copy of an antique piano leg. I mean, it was a real project to someone 100 years ago. And the plants are real with the same kind of shapes. And then our things are real in that they're simple, kind of straightforward materials of today. The arm on that couch over there, the oak, is all scrap, laminated up by a mill in Arkansas. He takes all of his scrap and he cuts it into little tiny pieces and he laminates it into boards just for us. And so even though that's a hardwood, I feel that it's okay to use. This is the culmination of a lot of time, and that was starting about 5 or 6 years ago, or actually more than that. Became very, you know, as a designer, just watching people in a room sitting talking and finding out, you know, what it takes to give someone a comfortable chair or seat. And then with more than one person or more than two people, what's the average size of group that people break up into at a party? Do they sit, stand, or whatever? And in addition to that, then, having a couple kids and whatever of myself, always kind of found that the best thing was a mattress on the floor. And because all the other things you saw before this now are pretty expensive now, and it takes a kind of typical person who is, you know, buys a car and buys a house and buys some furniture to be able to afford it, this was an attempt at developing a kit of parts, and it took a long time to really realize, well, what do people already have so that you can give them a very minimal addition to that, but it'll save them a lot of money. So I realized that everyone has a mattress already, and that by designing just a simple frame that would solve all these kind of small-scale social problems of groups of people in a room, that anyway, a lot of people would respond to that, I hoped, and it has proven itself. This is only 2 weeks old, this whole project, and it was in Home Magazine, and it has worked. I mean, usually, sometimes you can't tell that fast whether something's going to go over or not, but it seems to really work. We had proved it out ourselves for a long time. That's just sitting in the same room, kind of, to show you a little bit of scale. Anyway, there's just something about a certain amount of enclosure that I feel everyone needs. It's a slight bit of returning to the womb that makes a person feel kind of, you know, comfortable in a space or able to open up and talk to another person. And this was designed for also, you know, the average, what I consider to be an optimum distance between people in a small scale kind of social interaction environment. And that's something like 6 to 8 feet. And if you get further away, it's a lot harder to really feel what the other person is saying or meaning or whatever. And so whereas the rest of the society is finally coming around to realizing that, you know, one couch on each wall is not the best thing, and they're finally buying modular pieces and putting them together. In general, the size of what they're buying for about $2,000 is way out of scale to people, and it puts people still about 10 or 12 feet apart. And to a lot of people, I guess that's a comfortable distance. It's the same person that drives their 18-foot-long Cadillac, maybe, needs a lot of protection around them. But anyway, we have found that this size, and with up to 8, I guess I didn't bring any slides with people really using this. In fact, I forgot because I meant to. Up to 8 people sitting there very comfortably. Everyone moves, but first of all, you find that that you don't mind after about the first half hour. Even the most uptight people find that, well, gee, if you know, you're kind of your legs are on top of someone else's or whatever, you know, it doesn't make any difference. And that's a real hang-up we found, that you know, people really feel. They really are afraid to touch anyone else. This is, we have ourselves kind of tried to use a rooftop to a maximum extent in trying to use urban spaces that are otherwise totally, I guess you use your rooftop of this building. I see something up there anyway. But there's a lot of rooftop areas that go to waste. So we live right in the middle of Westwood, and what we developed was a system so that we would not be on touching the roof, but in this case, every one of these pallets sits on a block which is cemented to the roof, and so you're not touching it in any way. However, you can lift up each module separately to examine the roof and to repair the leaks if they occur. And all the canvas panels then relate to one pallet so that you can move them all individually too. So this project, that couch and that child's bed, the loft bed with everything underneath and opening up the floor space, were kind of what I consider the secondary look at the urban environment, whereas in the beginning we started thinking about materials and what was rational to use, and we thought about a commercial environment to sell that stuff in. And from that then, I've kind of come to develop a concern about space and maximizing space. This is a project that's a cardboard house, basically, one way, which was just a way of looking at the material and seeing what could be done with it. This is a student project from Art Center several years ago from a class I was teaching. A client came to me shortly after we started our business and said, we like your store so much that we want to have you design a house for us. And I said, gee, what makes you think I can design you a house? And they said, well, anyone who could design this stuff, we think, whether you're an architect or not, we want you to design our house. And I said, well, I do have a background in that, but I'm really too busy now to do it. And they kept coming back, and they they finally said, it's an architect's dream. They said, okay, now here's our bank book. You can see all the cash is in the bank. You won't have to get a loan on the house because as long as you can build it for this amount of money, you can do anything you want. And they said that not only that, but even if we don't like it, we guarantee you we'll live in it for 2 years. And at the end of that time, if we still don't like it, we'll sell it. So with that in mind, I finally had to give in and say, okay, I'll start working on this project. It was very bad timing because I told them that I was only interested in developing a particular type of building system that would entail really two systems. One was a series of shells, and then everything inside the shells was to be furniture, just kind of like the what I call super furniture, which you people have in here. They went along with it, and it was great. The only problem was I was too involved in that and this business, which was needed a lot of time. In the end, I found that even though the client really wanted it, I couldn't do both, and so I had to drop the house. Well, I had just put a certain amount of thinking in up to that point and analyzed different shapes. This is a half-scale model of a shape that is a truncated octahedron, which is the shape most resembling a sphere that will pack completely together. The reason I picked this is that it has square openings for windows and doors. Since this is a half-scale model, halfway up where the major floor would be, which is right up here, you have a lot of headroom. The angles are very not very steep, the angle of the walls. And the whole idea was to, you know, build an urban apartment housing system that would then have a whole series of flexible components on the inside which were changeable. Anyway, this is just the last little shot of one way of putting these things together. There are many ways, but that's the kind of carrot dangling out there that I still feel that we have developed a factory and learned a lot about production, about money, about design and detailing, so that eventually we can get back into designing or developing some type of housing systems. Okay, put that other one on real fast, I guess, and I'll just, this is something that, this is just a series of recent shots that, go ahead, change that. This is the other shot of that particular thing was not complete. This is the final version. What it includes is pretty much everything a child needs in his room, all in a very compact space. A bulletin board for him to express his whatever on. The desk is completely adjustable for height and angle. I guess it's in its about middle position there. Because I found that, you know, almost all children's furniture was rigid and was either designed for one period in his life or it was adult furniture that you better grow into someday before, you know, you're expected to use it. The chair is a recent design because I found out that I looked around for our own stores and found that there's really only one child's chair produced in the whole country that's decent at all, and that's in Scandinavia. And it sells for $110 here now because the devaluation of the kroner or whatever it is in Denmark. And so I decided to develop something that was changeable, that could grow with the child, and did a lot of measuring of kids' legs and backs and whatever. And so this is just a simple little chair that sells for under $50, which is still expensive, but to do what I wanted it to do, I couldn't get it any less. Anyway, with a whole height adjust as well as the back. The other idea is that any piece of furniture, any environment you develop for a child has to change with him over time also. So these are the very same components broken down either in a bigger room or when he's a little older. And that's something that it's important, believe it or not, to the average housewife too, who, you know, worries about plunking down a bunch of money and then having to do it again in another 5 years. So this. About $300, $300 to $400, depending on. Right now it's $300. It's got to go up because everything that we do, when we first come out with it, we put it at a price that seems reasonable. Now we always find out that in our factory, it is never reasonable and that it is always underpriced because there's much more labor in everything than I have figured. And the big tube bed that you saw there, we started out with at $200, and which seemed like an awful lot of money then. And it is. I couldn't afford one for my own kids, but now it's up to almost $600. And there's just no way to do it any other way, though. It's either take it off the market or sell it for what it has to cost. Believe it or not, those cheap tubes are very expensive. And to do the labor, put the labor in it to do it right, it just costs a lot. There's just no way around it. So everything else that is, let's say, something that we would like that comes on the market, it goes off the market because most stores won't keep anything unless they're either selling a lot of them, or department stores especially, you know, they'll buy something new every year and they won't really look at the merits of the design of a product. They'll look at how well it sells or how flashy something new is. And so those ideas seem to me the antithesis of what a thinking consumer wants. He wants something that works and will continue to work, like a Volkswagen instead of a changing Cadillac every year or something. So that's kind of the idea and the reason that we have taken a lot of time and effort into having some stores that we can keep something in front of the public's eye and keep developing it further so that it works better instead of just changing the whole thing every year. Okay. These are just other slides of the very same parts. Go ahead. Yeah. It's adjustable for a 5-year-old to a, let's see if there's another shot of it here. One thing I found out that children's legs between here and here grow a great deal, but the distance between their seat and their back, the small of their back or where they need support, this part only changes about 1.5 inches, whereas this changes about 6 inches. So to get around that and to keep something that was kind of in proportion and would change enough, the back see only has to change from an adult to a 5-year-old child by that 1.5 inches, or it's about 2 inches, I think, right there. Whereas the bottom, a 5-year-old child puts his feet right on the base of that chair, and that's perfect for him. And then an older child puts his feet on the floor, and then you go to the adjustment, you know, right at that point. That's just... The other thing we found out that was interesting to me is that the same thing from the other slides, is a lot narrower than this. It's a 30-inch wide mattress. Well, a 30-inch wide mattress is half the width of a queen-size bed, but if you ever show a mother this bed, which is a full 39-inch wide, it's really weird how some of our modules of furniture have developed. In Europe, a standard twin bed is 36 inches wide. Ours over here is really a full meter, even though we've never had the metric system, but it's 39 inches wide. And a mother comes in to sell her, you know, buy something for her little tiny kid this big, and you say, look at this mattress, it's 30 inches wide. Well, now, is that a standard twin? Well, actually, it isn't, but it's half the size of a queen-size mattress. Doesn't that seem big enough? Well, my junior is going to grow pretty big. And so we found that, I mean, people really worried that the mattress, a 30-inch wide mattress, is a pretty good size. I mean, I can sleep in it. Two people, if under tight conditions, can sleep in it. But mothers are the ones that buy for their children, and they think they're going to grow giants always. So we eventually had to change to this wider mattress, too. Okay. That's just a single version of it with a bed underneath. Oh, that's the same chair in another version, which is, you know, we offer it two ways always. So the very same thing, but in a plastic-edged version, which can be kicked around a lot, and with this whole other series of things we do. Go ahead. Go ahead. Oh, one other thing then, and these are fitted comforters that fit on the beds. If you are designing a product but don't consider the way the product is used, you know, you're only going halfway. So what we found is that, you know, what good does it do to give a person a new piece of bedroom furniture if the same old drudgery of making the bed is still there? So we developed this with our own fabric, of course, where we could kind of control the colors too. You know, a system. This is now a sleeping system. It's a fitted comforter that doesn't come off the child at night, that is both a top sheet, what am I trying to say? Anyway, it's everything you need except for one bottom sheet. The child can get up in the morning and flip it across the bed. The mother never has to worry about taking care of it. It always looks good. And but it just represents to me kind of an important point that you really, as a designer, whether it's an architect or a product designer, you have to look at the whole picture and kind of develop, you know, as much of the system, as much of the surrounding environment, let's say, or the social functions of the way the environment is used as possible. Yeah. We had a bad experience for a while. We found that some of our nice fabrics didn't look so nice after they were washed, and that was a real problem. But we found out it was all in the printing and the exact type of fabric, and after eating a lot of bad fabric, we found a way of making it completely washable. Oh, these are just the final version of these tubes. There's an interesting point about these. A lot of the appeal of something comes in the way it's displayed. We have these in our stores, and we don't sell that many of them because most people kind of don't see them really because they stick in corners or whatever, and there's a lot going on in a typical kind of room environment, so you really don't see them. And these, when they were set up at the photographer's studio with just the right lighting and each one kind of as a piece of sculpture, though, every person that came in said, "Wow, I really want one of those." So anything you design, I mean, whether it works or not, really depends a lot about the environment that it goes into. And we sold those big tubular beds in the very beginning to design research, and the guy either put them together upside down, never tightened them so they were all wobbly, or the other thing was you found that there was no one to even tell you about them, and finally you'd find some little old lady and she'd walk over and say, "Well, I don't know anything about those weird things, you know, they just came in last week." And so we found that, you know, if you're going to do the product and go to all that trouble, you sure better control the environment that it goes into, and in this case, even in our own stores, we find out we're falling down in the way we're showing something. Oh, this is just a quick series here, which is the end. We tried to show that, you know, a huddle couch, which we call this, is kind of a different way of life if you have one. And it isn't really a hype. When you have it, you really find that you do almost everything on it. And, well, it depends. But so anyway, we went to a lot of trouble and did for a series of, we're trying to do a brochure on this thing. There's a patent pending on it right now, yeah. It's such a simple kind of idea. I don't know why no one ever really did it before. But it's the structure underneath, it was very hard to develop a moment joint right where this comes together with that one, and there are four points around the thing, and still only have it be less than an inch high underneath there, so you didn't have to build an entire platform for the mattress. It became a real problem, and it was kind of fun to work out a kind of a double moment connection at that point. That would take, you know, if you take a 200-pound person sitting at the back right here, he can put an awful lot of force at that corner down there. Go ahead.
How did you do that?
That is work. That is working on a huddle cap, you see. We're going to try to do our own office at our factory so that I can have someone working on my huddle couch like that during the day. As long as Penny moves her office out, anyway. The joint is hard to describe. I mean, you really should come in the store and lift up the mattress and look at it, because there's a combination of tubes that cross each other, one through right through the middle of the other one. There's a built-in stiffener inside the bent portion of this. well, we better go on. Go ahead. They get better. Oh, it's also, you see, can be used for sleeping. Well, now this is just the... the whole idea of this couch, though, is that if you can put one of these in your living room, you can take your bedroom and make it into a studio or whatever, because it's something that you don't have to change it every night from a couch into a bed or whatever. All you do is there's a Flocati rug, which you just see in the corner there a little bit. The one in the middle? You better believe it, she was a Playboy centerfold, and go ahead.
We liked our furniture enough to trade work for, we did it for trade for furniture.
Right, we couldn't afford her. Oh, anyway, it's nice to meditate on a huddle couch, too. That was her sister, the other girl's sister right there. I have to look at these myself. I've never seen these projected before in my life. Interviewing the models for this project was really interesting, though, I'll tell you. That took two full days, and sometime when I have some time, I'll tell you what it's like to interview models for a project like this. The only problem is during the photography then, there are about 8 people involved, and it is costing an awful lot of money between the photographer and the 2 models. And so it is, I'm sure it's the same in directing a film, but everyone is sweating and everyone is worrying and everyone's trying to do it as fast as possible and do all these different shots. So I was a nervous wreck by the end of the day. Go ahead. Oh, this just shows it with, I got to sit by her in one shot. And just kind of to get this feeling of scale, we wanted to show what 4 people were like on it. Actually, they wouldn't let me be in it because this guy is very small and he, in the photographs, looked about right. But we also wanted to legitimatize this kind of, hippie contraption here that we had designed. So you see, I got dressed up in my very best duds, and which we had to rent, just to show the people from Playboy magazine that it could fit in their lifestyle too. Go ahead. Well, the frame is $139, and the entire thing with the Greek Flocati rug and the pillows is $595. The rug is something that is very expensive. But we found that it is the, if you're going to have a surface that you can stand on, sit on, or do anything on, and that doesn't look all messed up all the time and is very soft, there are very few things in that category made. This is 100% wool, hand-woven in Greece, but it'll stretch. It'll stretch in every direction. You can stand on it and jump off, and it won't look all wrinkled up. So that's why we sell it that way. That's why we sell the frame for people to do it for, you know, completely on their own and make it funky or whatever, but we can't, you know, do it all different ways. So this was kind of to show, gee, what happens when you invite a friend over, and very easy for your girlfriend to get bent out of shape there, because natural things happen on a huddle couch. Go ahead. Now these two young people were playing Scrabble, and it just, this natural thing happened. Somehow her clothes came off, and they decided to have some fun. See, we did a series of shots, I hope I'm not offending anyone here, a series of shots to use in different publications also. This is not your Better Homes and Gardens shot. They really started out playing Scrabble, though. Go ahead. And then in the end, we decided we were all very hungry, and if any of you remember the painting by Manet called Luncheon on the Grass, we decided to have a luncheon on the huddle couch. And this is it's backwards, unfortunately, but it's the most literal translation of Manet's painting that we could come up with. And in doing a little research about that painting, which was in 1865, we found out that it was a big scandal, not because of what he painted, but the fact that he must have been there during a real happening, which was this nude girl out in the park with two fully clothed guys. And so people had been painting nudes for years and years, and no one worried about it. But it was the contrast that people, you know, objected to, and the fact that it must have really occurred. They found out later on that it never did occur, and Manet took an old Greek painting or lithograph from years, you know, way back, of exactly the same people that were all nude, and put clothes on the guys and put it in a park setting. Although during the whole scandal, he never told anyone that, and it wasn't until years later that they really found out. Anyway. That was a very enjoyable shot for me. Okay, I think that's it. Go, settle. Okay. Now, that's been a long time. After 6 years of working day and night at this business, I have to admit that doing that project and then photographing it was the most fun. It made it all worthwhile. It's the good life, you see, that I'm finally getting to. Naked girls, and anyway. Well, the worst thing is that the photographer and I, decided that we had to photograph this way, and we decided that we better start interviewing some models. And then Penny found out that we were going to do this, so she invited herself along. Well, we found that, that first of all, it's very hard to get a nude model that has a lot of class and that is as nice above the shoulders as below the shoulders. And then we found that, first of all, it's a very kind of difficult business, because if you're going to get a job in that business, first of all, you have to go you have to go try out for every position. So the girls that we were interviewing were only going to work for us for 1 hour, and it took them 4 hours to come to our studio in Hollywood, test for the shooting. And we realized, and we only, we interviewed about 10 or 15 girls to pick the two. So I decided that it isn't all, even though they made a lot of money for the time they were there, that it isn't all gravy in that business. Now, what kind of questions does anyone have, if anything?
What did you do with that ideal client?
Well, believe it or not, the guy was so ideal that when I told him I couldn't do the project, and I said, I have friends, architects that will be glad to do it and take on the project and finish it for you, they said, no, we want you to wait, even though, how long will it be? And I said, it might be a couple of years. And they said, no, we'd rather just, they had flown me up to Big Bear to pick out a lot. I'd picked a lot out for the house, and a nice hillside lot with trees and whatever. So when I decided I couldn't do it, they said, okay, they'd wait. And they waited for 4 years. And just last year, they finally decided they couldn't wait anymore. And one of the better things for me was that they had already started paying me the commission when I was working on it. Although the commission didn't pay for the real development, the structural analysis that we did on that whole system, which proved out completely structurally sound anyway, took a computer and a lot of computer and man hours to analyze, because there are no, we were really serious about building it and getting building code approval and everything. We had pages of printout from, synthesizing the shape with a graphic system and stuff. Anyway, so finally they asked for their commission back in furniture, in trade, because they were going to move out of the state. So I furnished an entire kidney research center at the National Children's Hospital in Washington, D.C., because this is a doctor that was involved in kidney research. So that was my only good client. If it would have come 6 months before, my entire life would have changed. And I would have, who knows, I would have been, I don't know. Anything else?
What size of a factory do you have now?
Oh, we have about 20,000 square feet. I realize, though, to do building systems, you need a lot bigger than that. One of the biggest problems with building systems is that is very hard to develop and plan out and schedule the parts, any kind of building parts, because of all the problems of building officials, selling them, everything else. And that's what has always happened to all the people that have tried to develop housing systems, let's say, that they couldn't keep a factory going while they were waiting for the building officials to make up their minds on whether you should use, what type of duct on your toilet, vent or something. And so, ideally, by having a factory that does two things, one of them can pay the overhead on the factory, being the kind of furniture and super furniture part of it, and the shell structure is a part that can kind of work in spurts on a kind of an assembly line basis when you need it. All idealistic. HUDL stands for Hull Urban Design Development Laboratory, etc. And it came from, I felt that I was an urban designer, that's what I wanted to be, that I didn't want to be an architect, and I didn't want to call myself an architect, and I didn't want to work for anyone for the period of time necessary to get that little license that says you are officially an architect. If there was any architect around that I felt good enough about, I would have, but I couldn't find anyone. So I felt that I wanted to, be a person involved in research of urban designs for urban living, whether that was building systems or what it is now as furniture for urban living, and trying to analyze, as I said, the differences of urban life and what, trying to meet the needs of those. So Penny never has liked that name, and she came home and I was so excited. I got a name I really like. What we're going to do, whatever it is, this is going to be what we're going to call it. And I think that's dumb. HUDL. And it's probably true. The et cetera on the end is very important. That I felt that anything we did, though, I wanted to remain kind of open as to what it would become. That's the one thing I hated about planning. And I spent a whole year with Kevin Lynch at MIT. And he and I were always at odds because I had read my planning books in architecture school and read Kevin Lynch's Image of a City. And then when I got there and I did a lot of thinking about the environmental impacts of, I mean, the psychological impacts of urban forms, I found that I disagreed a lot with him. And I disagreed a lot with planners in general because planners were planning long-range things. And once they got them planned with your long vistas and whatever it is, they weren't going to, they're not going to be things that are going to change. So if the life changes around them or in them, there was no way to change them. So that's one, the biggest thing that made me get out of planning and into systems that can change.
Do you have any anticipation of how much longer before
we should get into building systems? Well, depends on whether you're talking to my accountant, my wife, or me. My accountant will say, never. He'll say, you're going to have to make so much money at what you're doing now before you can ever do that you'll probably never get there. I feel that when I'm 50 years old, I probably won't feel like spending the amount of time that it takes to really develop a system. I mean, the last system, not the huddle couch, but the tubular furniture system for children, looks really simple, probably, the way it is now. But the number of exact details that went into making that really a system of parts instead of a piece of furniture, and a system of parts, kind of this Bucky Fuller's maximum, minimum inventory, maximum diversity. I mean, if we're going to have a factory, we have to keep our inventory down, but be able to offer maximum amount of diversity to, people, consumers. How did I get on that from the... So anyway, the more I know about business, I realize it's really hard to get to that point. What it really takes are people who can, like they're in school, like where you are now. In fact, we have a UCLA student in an apprentice program right now. You find that if you have a business, every person who is, being paid by that business and not doing productive stuff, the stuff that brings money in, is, a real liability from the accountant's point of view. And so it becomes very difficult, and therefore the only design time that I have, it comes after 12 o'clock at night and on every weekend. And so it all depends on whether we decide to. Ideally, this company was set up to get to that point. I have made a vow that I'm not going to go the way of most other furniture designers, or which is just kind of getting worse and worse and doing change for the sake of change. And therefore, if we don't eventually get to it, instead of doing those rehashes of the same thing, we'll get rid of it and we'll sell it, hopefully, and then go to the next stage. I can't even recommend, unfortunately, that anyone try to do an integrated system of design, manufacturing, wholesaling, and retailing of an entire kind of mini environment, because after knowing what it takes now, I could recommend a lot of what parts of it I would do, maybe, but it's almost a sure road to bankruptcy. I mean, if General Motors tried to do it, they would have spent $100 million in the same amount of time that we, and to maybe, or maybe not $100 million, maybe $20 million, to come up with what we've done. And I know why now, because I know what, you develop your own little bureaucracy, and if it's a big company, it's really much worse than in a little company. So therefore, it's even harder. I knew four guys that started this big waterbed store chain, and they went through $4 million and did 30 stores before they went bankrupt. And it's just, it takes, you know, the other thing, there's a really important thing about any kind of business that may, or any type of design that any of you ever feel really strongly about. And this came from a guy that we met who had absolutely no design background in the world. And he said, until he was 30 years old, in fact, he was a total absolute failure. He hadn't done anything right. He had not gotten out of school even. And something turned him on about some stores in the East, design research being one of them. And so what he did is start a chain of stores in the Southeast and in Texas. And it is, it's definitely the nicest chain of retail contemporary stores in that whole part of the country. And what he said was, you know, he came out here to see our stuff, and we had seen him and everything, became pretty good friends. And he said, you know, he said, people, he said, I ripped off another store chain. I mean, he learned whatever he could from design research, that was one of them, and then another store in Washington, D.C., to start his own thing. And then he realized that his own thing was totally different. And he said, people are always thinking that they're going to come in and look at my, you know, the way I do things, and then they're going to go out and do their own thing just like it. And it's really untrue. He said, you know, no one can steal another man's dream. And it's absolutely true that it'll only work if it's a dream. You know, if there's something dangling at the end, it'll keep you working on it, it'll keep you solving all the thousands of problems that come up all day. And, you know, somehow you're able to do it, whether it's a design of a building, a city, or whatever. But if you don't have that one kind of little dream at the end, and then once you get it going, it's true. No one else can, you know, with their $100 million even come in and copy your dream. They can, you know, they can copy part of it. Our plant stands are the simplest little thing we've ever done. And we were ripped off by two companies in the East, which really did hurt us in the back there, because we sold most of those in the East. That's where it ended. I mean, to them, they're out of, they only sell a few now, and, you know, what do they go on to? Well, that was just a tiny thing to us. I mean, that was just a stepping stone, a way of getting some bread coming in to do other things. So you can't ever kind of look at what you're doing now. It's kind of doing, you know, what you want to be doing 50 years from now. Anything else? Penny, you haven't said anything. Maybe you should. Okay.
Your dyes.
Yeah. Well, they're acrylic dyes. They're hand silk screened on long, 150-foot long tables. It's horrendous to silkscreen big, solid areas of color, we found out. Well, there's a good reason why no one does big, bold graphic things. Several good reasons. One is that silkscreeners hate it, because it's very difficult to have a perfect surface over a large area. You know, there are either imperfections in the fabric, imperfections in the screen. The screen and the fabric itself can create a moiré pattern where they overlap just slightly different, you know. There are slight differences in viscosity of the printing inks will change the color, will allow it to run, will make bubbles. It's a really hard thing to do big, bold things. For that reason, we have a lot of rejects, and so we also make pillows now. We cut up the rejects, and we make little pillows, and a lot of people like the little pillows better than they do the big fabric, because everyone needs a pillow. Saul?
Talks about designer giving an attention. consciously their own time, or maybe their own piece of mind, design it socially, consciously, you know, you tend to have to ask the question. You have, like all the research you've done with the children thing, and you put that together for people who don't know anything about it, or something, so that other people can take advantage of all that research you've done.
You mean, like, putting the information in book form? No. that is something that this guy, eventually everyone, I guess, does. All these studies, I don't know if you have that from Henry Dreyfuss Associates, that finally Neil Diffriant put together that whole series of charts and everything about human shapes, and all he did was take the years of research from their, you know, design office and put it all together into a really usable form. This guy in England right now, Terence Conran, that started the Habitat stores over there, did this really, I don't know how to describe it really. It's a very good book called The Home Book or something like that, The Home or something. And he took, you know, years worth of thinking and photographs and everything and put it into a book that the average person, in fact, can read. Yeah, we're trying to put it together, a bunch of information into some kind of a catalog form. That the first function of it, of course, is to try to sell someone on something. The discouraging thing to us at this point is distribution and production. I mean, it's very difficult to expand production. A factory is horrendous, and trying to run a furniture factory and to keep mistakes to a minimum and quality at least reasonable, and labor problems and employees' checks from bouncing, and the factory part is by far the hardest. It's horrendous. I mean, I really think that most factories should be small people's back garages and very personal somehow, after, you know, our experiences. And everyone I've known who's been in manufacturing, in furniture anyway, feels the same thing, that there need to be more people, you know, in Downey and La Puente or somewhere with a big garage doing, well, to give you an example, when I first started making the furniture and Penny sold it in the store, and I thought, boy, I need some help. And then I realized that I had to do a lot of other things, so I wanted to hire someone to do what I was doing. It took 3 full-time people to do what I was doing, because I knew it firsthand. I had, you know, my heart into it, and it is absolutely true. It took 3 people to do what one person was doing. And so that's really a problem with production. Now, the bigger you get, there's a whole huge gray area between, you know, a one-person operation and a maybe 2 or 3-person operation where everyone is a specialist, and then to the point where anything really makes sense. And that's something like the difference between, you know, 2 or 3 people and then at least 50 people. And it's something that I would have never guessed, you know, but everything, or 50 people, or then, you know, the size of General Motors or something, where they're, yeah, it's horrible, but to think about really creating and producing something, you just have to do it at such a large scale to make it ever profitable. But, and for a lot of small reasons, so things that designers like me never thought about, you know, you really need a whole chain of command so that, you know, one person doesn't have to do everything and be responsible for everything, because it drives them crazy. So then you need not only the people that are doing all the specialized parts, but a specialist in charge of the people. And I've always tried to be a generalist and not a specialist, and so it amazes me always that you have to reach that certain level to really produce anything of several different layers, or kind of a hierarchy from the original idea to finally having it come out at the other end. And it's different from architecture. It's not architecture, because architecture is you don't care about how many of them you make or whatever. It's making that one perfect edifice and whatever it costs, and bringing marble from Vermont and, you know, but producing something. And you know, I've my ideas about products have really changed since I really.
How would you do it differently if you could do it over again?
Well, the problem is, if I were to do it over again, if I knew anything in the beginning that I know now, I would have never done it. I mean, absolutely, I would never do it. If I even knew 1% of what I knew now, I'd realize that it was hopeless and there was no way to do it. So I would have never tried, and I don't know what I would have done. I mean, oh yeah, I mean, we've made it past. Yeah, you shouldn't know, you know, especially about business. You know, to be, and this is a real problem too. Any of you designers, if you ever really think that, you know, you want to have a business, there's just opposite things that happen between a designer and a businessman. And a businessman looks first at money and profits, and then he looks at, you know, how much you've sold to make that money. And then somewhere down the line, it was what you sold. And as a designer, you look first at what it is and how well it works and what it looks like and what other people think about it. And then, you know, in my case, I tried to think about how it was sold. And then after a long time, you figure, well, gee, you know, where's the money that I started, you know, I mean, I got into this thing to at least make some money, and you find out that the money is really never there at all, and that it all goes into salaries, and that's a whole other thing. Unless you reach a certain level, either you go way back to the one-person thing, and you get a bunch of people in their garages in La Puente making them for you, and all you do is get the mail in and take the checks in and send it to your garage in La Puente, and he sends it out, and that's a good way of working. Or you then get past the 50-person factory up to I don't know how many hundreds of people and I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of square feet to whether hopefully there's something left at the end of the month. And you know, but I don't recommend learning about business first and then going into it anyway, because it's so depressing that as a designer it'll kill your enthusiasm. So just jump in if you ever want to, you know, do anything. Well, I've probably never come in contact with, what is a real architect, I guess? I mean, my impression of what architects do is not, I guess, what I believe in for certain reasons. So therefore, I mean, there have been some idealistic architects that I've known in the past that I liked as people, and I know what they thought that they were doing was good. It's kind of like what you said tonight. You know, you have to either decide that you're going to do something, but if it's like in architecture right now, there's nothing that I feel I could do that wouldn't be a mistake. And so that's what I really picture most architecture as being, is a lot of mistakes. There are very few people around that I feel that are really doing. I guess mistakes to me, though, is not spending more in the way of either money or energy or materials or whatever it is, not wasting those things. And I feel that most architectural projects do waste them. And so all I'm trying to do is develop a more efficient way of working with money, energy, and materials. And hopefully we'll create some habitable structures someday.
I'm curious, being a former Ralph Knowles student, we have staffers in this country, is one here, Tom Main is one. They both seem to abandon everything they learned from Ralph Knowles. How do you feel about that? Your own?
Well, okay. I was not as influenced literally as much by Ralph Knowles for a couple reasons. When I first started in architecture, I had been... Okay. I feel that Ralph Knowles was really way kind of ahead of his time in analyzing ecological systems and their effect on building structures and living environment. Definitely. What in, you know, saying that we just couldn't keep building glass boxes without looking at the, you know, the heat loads coming through those clear glass windows when everyone else was just saying put in a bigger air conditioner. And we did, worked months on building little solar little machines to put a model on and analyze where the sun was at different parts of the year, at different months of the year and different times of day, to design and develop structures which would keep the sun, especially in Southern California, to a minimum on, you know, hitting that surface. After us, classes that worked years on developing wind machines and developing forms that would, where the forms themselves were as a result of the wind. Now, I'm not sure in that case what they were saving. I don't think that they were actually capturing the wind and using it to create energy like maybe they could have, but they were analyzing the flow of wind around structures in the same way that you do it, let's say, for, you know, when you're designing a race car. Anyway, I felt, see, I came into that program after being in 2 years of humanities and thinking that I was going into architecture, not knowing what architecture was, and found that Ralph Knowles was there with an incredible terminology that most of the words I didn't even understand. And it really took me, the whole first year I was in a daze. I did what we were supposed to be doing, but I, you know, I didn't learn it really literally. But then every year went on, and I understood more and more. The thing that struck me as being the most valid in the entire program was a way of analyzing any kind of a design problem. And that was, you start with the basics, and the basics being the forces which act on any type of structure. Now, as I said in the beginning, I felt that the analyzing the natural forces was really not enough, and that then we had to go to the economic forces and then the social and psychological forces and stuff. But I guess that's what I would have to say. In other words, I just didn't take it as literally, but I thought as a way of working. And the other good thing about it, of course, was that there were no literal, there were no architects saying, now this is what the building is, you know, it's a sharp corners or, which is, I stayed away from even in my fifth year at USC, where there was a program with the critics that would come in, well-known practicing professionals, and then you got to work with a real architect in a real kind of situation. Well, I got out away from that, thank goodness, by going working with Voxman that year in a seminar type of situation. So I still feel that in any architectural setting that you don't need, you know, practicing people that are telling you exactly how to do it, or, you know, and I'm sure in this school, from the way it looks, there aren't too many of those.
Did you ever do anything in larger urban design or city?
Okay, the two things that I did do, the first was the project, the model, which neither of them really real, okay? The one was a design of a new town in Finland while I was at MIT. It was a real project in Finland. However, you know, my particular solution never got built, and neither did anyone else's. But it was a real problem with real people, with real figures. I reacted very negatively to that project because I said I didn't live in Finland all my life, and there's no way you're going to, you know, give me that problem. So I said, this is a real city in Southern California because I feel that I know that environment and can design for it. I really think that, you know, the region that that any design is intended for has to be a space that you really know. You know every part about it, not just even how the sun hits it or something, but there are all kinds of social and things that you really have to know to be able to design for it. So that's why that project I really didn't believe in. The other thing was we tried to develop in this community group at MIT and Harvard a way of making a real cooperative community that could exist between the people in a low-income area of the city and a group of other people, which was this faculty and student group, where we could each give each other something that we had. We wanted to help these low-income people develop businesses and help them with their physical environment. And the business aspect was a way of developing cooperative businesses where we would put in a lot of expertise and kind of even the seed money to get them going. And we found that, first of all, no one wanted either. It was our own little thing that we wanted to do, but the people in this in the city, this happened to be in an area, a low-income area of Boston, that they didn't care. And when they started telling us about the things they really did care about, we learned an awful lot. We learned things like a new housing system that was put up in Boston, and the people hated it, and they broke all the windows, and it was supposed to be exactly what they wanted. It was all one story, basically small units. They all faced a green grass area, and they hated it. And when it really got down to the people, you know why they hated it? Because there was a central walkway coming right down the middle, and then, you know, doors there and there and there and there, and front windows by the doors. And the reason they hated it is in their whole society, it was very common for the women of the house to have lovers. And the way the streets in Boston were, it was very easy for a person to walk along the sidewalk, walk up to a door, and go in. And the other windows were at a level, because there's a basement down below, there was a level high enough that someone could walk by without the neighbor seeing them. So, you know, the architects had analyzed the needs of these people and designed exactly what they thought they wanted, and they hated it because it had a very bad effect on their sex life. Everyone knew who was sleeping with who else, and that created all kinds of problems. So they found out that what these people really wanted were back doors that people could come in and out of. And those are the kind of things that, I mean, more and more, I'm sure these are the things that good architects are trying to find out before they design, you know, buildings for people. It's a south end, but it was a new kind of redevelopment area in that case anyway. What? Yeah. You can tell how long the milkman stayed in each time. It was absolutely true. I mean, they were serious about it, and the neighbors hated each other because they would develop all these animosities between that, you know, who lived over there, because they knew who was coming in the day and stuff, and all the women were always against each other, and so it was an interesting experience. I don't know if those are the kind of projects that students here are learning about or not. Well, I'm sure. Although that was the only one that we could come up with after talking to a lot of people there. That was the main one that caused a lot of problems within it, you know. Physically, if we had occasion to go in some of these old buildings in Boston. I mean, we living in suburban, you know, Los Angeles, cannot comprehend what some of these buildings in the older cities look like on the inside. On the outside, they aren't even that bad. And I found it was just such an experience. First of all, you walk in the door of a building and you forget that what a building can smell like until you're there. I mean, you figure that in some of those buildings, people have been urinating on the walls and the floor and the hallways for 50 years or 100 years. And it's something that we never even think about. You know, you don't think about that. You think, well, we'll go into that old building and we'll refurbish it and we'll paint it up. You know how you get rid of a smell like that? And so there are things like that that you can only experience if you do them. If you go, and I don't know, in L.A., it's even hard in L.A. probably to find the kind of buildings that exist in a lot of other cities in the country and in the world.
Well, thank you very much.
Sure.